I started keeping track of the Billboard charts when I was about 7 or 8, you know, and then when I was 13, I went up to Billboard because I wanted to go backtrack and go to the years before, and you know, when I didn't, and I met Tom Noonan, a wonderful man, who he was the chart editor, and brought me in. He introduced me to Paul Ackerman, the music editor, who was a great mentor of mine, and the first publisher or writer to be inducted into the Rock and Roll Hall of Fame himself. I started just writing down the years previous from the 40s and everything, just to catch up on what I had missed. But I soon realized, being in the Plaza Theater building on 47th Street and Broadway, that everything was happening right outside my door. All these great indie record companies in New York, and publishers in the Brill Building, and the three of the four major labels of the day, RCA, Columbia, and Decca, were all very close by, and you know, so I hung around Billboard for a lot more to learn what was going on right now, and they invited me to some of their review sessions, which were at night, and they had what was called do bills, where they would put in free advertising for these little hotels, and they'd give them, you know, credit for rooms. So I sometimes was on Wednesday nights, and what's somebody playing?
There's a
nobody's dead. Why are they playing the organ?
We have an adjacent venue connected to the store. So
somebody
go back there and tell them to shut up. Mr. Stein is talking over here.
No, it's all right. I can, you know. I learned so much at Billboard, and I met so many people. I met Ahmet Erdogan and Jerry Wexler and Leonard Chess and Lou Chudd from Imperial Records, and, you know, guys from Specialty Records, all the great indies. But most of all, I met a guy named Sid Nathan from King Records, who took me under his wing and invited me to spend some time in Cincinnati over the summer with his family, so he could teach me more of the music business. He said, you know, he said, I think you could be a player. He said, not just, you know, a reporter or a journalist. He said, I think you got real ears. And it was so complimentary. And I met James Brown, one of his artists, Hank Ballard, and some of his country artists as well. And it was all, you know, wonderful. Though they knew every move I made, I come home from a long trip in England. I'm so tired. 10 minutes later, the phone rings. It's Johnny Ramone. We got some new songs, you know? And, you know, everything was, you know? And we want you to hear him, you know? So I said, Johnny, I just walked in. I said, and it was a Sunday. I said, look, give me a day. Come in and see me Tuesday, anytime you want. He says, look, we know you're free on Wednesday night, so we booked ourselves into CBGB's. I said, fine, great. So I checked who the opening act was, and it was a band that I didn't like enough to sign, and they were managed by Hilly Crystal, who I love and miss very much, called the Shirts. So I didn't want to show up and try to see the Shirts and have them kind of push them on me again. So I was waiting outside. It was the middle of November, but it was a very, very, very warm day for November. I'm out there with Lemmy Kay, and you all know who Lemmy Kay is from the Patti Smith Band. And all of a sudden I hear, when my love stands next to your love, and all of a sudden, I don't want to get emotional, but I'm sucked into the room, you know, like, it's amazing. You know, and he's following me. I said, this isn't the Shirts, what's going on? He says, oh, Hilly got him a paying job in Brooklyn. He says, this is Talking Heads. And God, as much as I loved them, every song, I couldn't wait till they were finished. I tried to help Tina down, you know, they had no crew, nothing, you know. And she was so nice to me. I mean, and I'm not just saying that because her son is here tonight, but because it's the God honest truth. And then all of a sudden, David Byrd says to me, we know who you are. He said, this isn't the, he said, and he writes down an address. He said, this is our loft. Call us and come see us tomorrow. And I did, and I made them a deal, an offer. And they said, well, we'll think about it. You know, we're working on video. We go back to Rhode Island a lot. Well, it was the worst period, 11 and a half months, waiting for them to agree and sign the contract, which I raised up a little bit and everything. I said, somebody is going to swipe this band out from under me. This band is so unique and so special and everything. And, you know, 11 and a half months later, November 1st of the following year, they signed the contract. I mean, and that, oh, God. I felt like the weight had been removed from me. It was so wonderful. And, of course, there's never been a band like them, and there never will be.
Yeah. Truly the biggest artist that was ever on Sire. And I want to read a quote from when you're talking about Madonna to ask you a question about. I saw Madonna struggling to find a producer, but I knew not to interfere. There would have been no point trying anyways. The way I've always viewed this game is that once you sign artists, you give them their shot. My job is to support them among the Warner brass, get them money, videos, good sleeves, proper service. If an artist asked for help, whether it was finding a manager, lawyer, producer, dentist, rehab clinic, or whatever else, I was Mr. Address Book. If the artist wanted total control over their music, then fine, but you always let them work their way, which is very admirable, you know, in the time, you know, I think.
Well, it's the least I could have done. I couldn't pay big advances, so what I could offer them as much as possible was freedom. Right. And that's what I did. And, you know, I didn't know it at the time, but Madonna had been looking for a deal for over 2 years. And one of my idols, and I don't have that many idols on that side of the fence, you know, my side of the fence, Chris Blackwell turned her down. And I mean, look, we all make mistakes, but the thing is that Chris is, you know, Bob Marley and so much more than that, you know, but, you know, so.
Giving artists complete artistic control, were there ever times where you had to, like,
I didn't give him complete. Are you kidding? Please. You know, I didn't go out and buy drugs for them. Please.
Well, did you ever have a moment where you had to, like, really, you know, bite your lip from being like, you know, Madonna, I don't know if the...
With Madonna?
Or any of your artists that
Madonna, first of all, you know, you all know how talented she is. Let me tell you, she's more brilliant even than she's talented. She's so smart, you know, and just incredible. No, not in the very beginning, but soon after, I caught Sina, got out of her way because, you know, she knew where she was headed. When she wanted to start her own label, I helped her start it, which was part of Siren, Warner Brothers, and all of that. And, you know, so, you know, but, no, Madonna, you know, I love all my artists, but, I wouldn't say who I like more, but it would be hard for me to think of anyone smarter than Madonna. I will say that because that has nothing to do with talent.
Fair enough. So the two things that stood out from, like, the whole book, I think the two greatest strengths.
Excuse me.
I have a question about Madonna. So she's had a long career and been quoted in the press and had a lot of scandals and stuff. So what kind of scandal is most memorable to you from Madonna?
I really, you know, that wasn't my side of the business. I took care of the music, you know, and I mean, I didn't. In fact, she took care of the music, and I just helped her along. I think a lot of the scandals, well, I don't know, but a lot of them were made up and overly fabricated and all of that. It's none of my business how people live, you know. I mean, if, and she was never drugs or anything like that, you know, there were a couple of times I tried to intervene with some of the artists who, you know, were getting a little bit too involved. And I'm not saying, look, I was no saint either myself, so I mean, you know, I don't want it, but no, never.